Vertical farms are supposed to be the answer.
Another vertical farm files for bankruptcy.
Vertical farm startup files for Chapter 11.
Bankruptcy.
A way of feeding a ever-increasing world population. And do it all with less water and by stacking vertically, grow more produce on less acreage. It all sounds like a brilliant idea. And yet fast forward to 2024 and vertical farm after vertical farm is failing and going bankrupt. So what happened? This sounds like such a good idea on paper, but clearly something's not working. So we need to get to the bottom of what exactly is going on, because this one surprised me. And there's actually a little bit more to the story than I realized, so stick around till the end. I'm Ricky, and this is 2-Bit Vinci. This video is sponsored by Ground News. Over $2 billion were invested in vertical farms in 2022. With hundreds of startups and vertical farms promising to make farming possible in large urban hubs. By 2023, the vertical farming market was already worth over $5 billion. Seemingly with every venture capital firm around the world, with fear of missing out, looking to invest in the next big vertical farming unicorn. This story actually goes back further than you might think. Vertical farms have been popular since the mid-1990s. In 2020, there were only about 100 well-funded vertical farming companies, but fast forward to 2023, and there were over 2,000 of them in the US alone, and many more in Europe, Asia, and the Middle East. Some of these companies were on a rocket ship ride to reaching unicorn status, which is basically a private company startup that's worth over $1 billion. For example, the German company Infarm, founded in 2013, was the first unicorn vertical farming startup, raising over $600 million and reaching a valuation of over $1 billion in 2021. Bowery Farming was the second unicorn, worth around $2.3 billion in 2021. There was real buzz in the air and the excitement was palpable. People actually thought that Silicon Valley might have finally solved the farming sustainability problem. The benefits of vertical farming were widely publicized. Better crop yields, for example, where vertical farms could produce multiple times higher output than regular farms or even greenhouse farming. Another big key point was the reduction in water use, up to 90% or more. And this is really, really important because depending on where you're trying to build this farm, water might become increasingly scarce. And of course, there was year-round production where it didn't really matter what season it was or what the weather was like outside, you could grow your crops all the time. Another big thing was land use reduction, using up just a fraction of the land, and by building upward, you could have similar outputs on much less land. This really mattered because this allowed you to grow food in more densely populated urban areas as opposed to from halfway around the world. It also actually minimized the use of pesticides because you can control the environment and it was indoors. You wouldn't have as much bugs and bacteria to contend with. And finally, vertical farms had the potential, at least, to be highly automated. By the way, have you ever wondered how we do our research for our videos? Just put up on Google, right? Wrong. Our news is broken because our political views determine which version of the story you hear, which is crazy, and why my team and I research all of our stories using Ground News. Check this out. This is what I found when researching a recent video on Boeing and the 737 MAX. Using Ground News, you can quickly see who's covering this story, which way they lean, and see how there's uneven coverage, and a blind spot for left-leaning publications with this particular story. You'll see amazing metrics too, like coverage details, bias distribution, publication factuality, and ownership. It's like having superpowers to cut through the news headlines. And if you really want to see the power of Ground News, try pulling up some various presidential headlines right now. So if you want to get to the truth behind the headlines, use my link, ground.news/2bit, and you'll get 30% off their unlimited access Vantage plan for just about $5 a month. Huge thanks to Ground News and you. Now back to the show. That was the promise, but the reality, unfortunately, is starting to sink in. In 2023, impatient investors started dropping out of the market. And we'll get to why they did in a minute. Venture capital investment fell from $2.1 billion in the first three quarters of 2022 to just $275 million in the same period in 2023, a drop of almost 90%. But why does that matter? I mean, in most industries, yes, less investment means things will take longer, there's less growth, but it doesn't mean that companies will just come crashing down. However, that's precisely what's happening with the vertical farming industry. fifth season, a robo-farming company was among the first to go belly up in late 2022. Here's how the former VP at fifth season, Chris Cerveni, explains what happened to the company. We had tech investors in Silicon Valley, and they had expectations of how fast things were going to come out. Everybody was pulling back, so the funding was not readily available. Also, the burn in vertical farming is very high. But that was only the beginning. All major players were failing. In March 2023, Upward Farms, which had raised almost $150 million and had broken ground on a new 250,000 square foot vertical farm in Pennsylvania in 2022, announced it would cease all vertical farming operations. Also, New Jersey's Aero Farms, Kentucky's AppHarvest, and Planted Detroit all filed for bankruptcy. Infarm, the German unicorn, also closed operations in Denmark, the UK, France, the Netherlands, Germany, completely exiting the European market. Calera, the company with the most vertical farms around the world, also filed for Chapter 11 bankruptcy in April. And one of the biggest of all, Bowery Farms, took a heavy blow to its valuation. While they didn't file for bankruptcy, the company that was valued at $2.3 billion in 2021 was written down to just under $350 million by the end of 2023 and had to do two massive layoffs to stay afloat. That really sucks. This is a technology that I was really rooting for. But to better understand why this is happening, we should probably learn a little bit more about vertical farming. Imagine growing plants in a sealed skyscraper or building instead of a field. That's the essence of vertical farming. In vertical farming, crops grow vertically in stacked trays or containers, maximizing the use of surface area. Plants don't need soil. They get their nutrients from a special water solution delivered directly to the roots by hydroponics or aeroponics. But the key is lighting. We replace regular sunlight with special LED lights that mimic the natural light spectrum plants need to grow. Lighting in vertical farms takes advantage of a certain principle that plants don't actually use all the light from the sun. It's only special wavelengths. So vertical farms use special LEDs that produce light in two colors that plants love. Blue LEDs provide blue light that help plants grow, while red LEDs promote flowering and fruiting. By adjusting the amount of red and blue light, farmers can optimize plant growth depending on the crop. That's why whenever you see a picture of a vertical farm, they always look sort of purple, combination of both. Finally, vertical farms also closely monitor and control temperature, humidity, and air circulation to create the perfect environment for each crop, regardless of season or what's happening outside. After looking at the technology and comparing it to normal agriculture, I noticed several clear cons. You need a lot more high-tech equipment and sensors, which are just more expensive up front. It seems kind of silly to buy high-tech LEDs in red and blue to mimic sunlight when we could just use the sun for free. And operating a vertical farm also requires much more skilled workers with knowledge of plant science, engineering, and controlled environment agriculture. Not only are these skills harder to find, but they also lead to much higher labor costs compared to hiring some field hands to work a farm. And after a bit of digging, I also discovered that vertical farms are much more prone to certain risks like pest and disease, since both the water and the air are circulated in a closed loop system. So the very benefit that they were trying to go for, controlling the environment, can very quickly turn on you as well. Also, have you noticed that practically all the stuff that comes out of a vertical farm is lettuce, basil, and other leafy greens? How on earth are we gonna feed the world with nothing but green salad? Where are the fruits and vegetables at? Well, that has to do with vertical farms' biggest Achilles heel. Let's use vertical farming's most beloved and popular crop as an example, lettuce. This table shows an average yield of lettuce in different types of farms. You can see that the vertical farms have much higher productivity than traditional farming. A small container vertical farm can yield 14 pounds of lettuce per square foot, as much as 33 times more than the industrial open field farming and over 20 times more than a hydroponic greenhouse. This doesn't just work with lettuce, it happens with most other crops you can grow in a vertical farm. So yes, vertical farms are way more productive than normal farms per square acre. But that doesn't make them profitable. There's more to the equation than just growing more lettuce per acre of land. What if you have no shortage of land? That doesn't really matter, right? It comes down to the price of a head of lettuce. No one's paying more for the same lettuce grown in a vertical farm. And this is where it gets complicated, because vertical farms have costs that traditional farms don't. How about electricity, running all those LED lights and robots 24/7? So that's gonna eat into your profit. Well, here's what I found for a full year of vertical farming. Notice that contrary to what I initially thought, electricity doesn't make up most of the cost. It's less than 10% of the total cost of a head of lettuce. The highest cost comes from labor, which, as I mentioned before, is more expensive than a normal farm. And in this case, contributes almost half of the overall cost. The second highest expense is capital expenses. This comes from high initial investment in everything from equipment, sensors, heat pumps, AC, heating, cooling, and the like. And then there's the maintenance of all that equipment. And that works out to a cost of $5.26 per pound of lettuce, or about $4 per head. And that's the price at the farm. Imagine what you might end up paying at the supermarket. Take a minute to think about how much you paid for your last head of lettuce. Let me know in the comments below. This will depend on where you live, obviously. But I'm guessing it's less than $5.25. How about in a traditional open field farm? Here's what the cost would look like. The numbers speak for themselves. Producing a pound of lettuce on a field costs 6 times less than a vertical farm. Yes, you can argue that there are higher shipping costs because farms are further away from the people that need them. But these supply chains are super optimized and add very little to the actual end price of lettuce. Vertical farms' problem isn't that we're using LEDs instead of free sunlight. It's that labor and capital costs are way too high. In farms, you don't even have to worry about how much your land losing value will cost you every year, because it doesn't lose value. It's farmland. In a vertical farm, not only do you have to spend hundreds, sometimes millions of dollars to set up a vertical farm, but that farm loses value over time as your assets and equipment depreciate. And if you're wondering, what does a head of lettuce or a pound of lettuce cost here in the US? About $2.60. And that's to the consumer, which means that the wholesale price that the farmers are selling it at is $63 to $1.26 per pound. And that's why these farms just cannot compete, especially if where they're established have high labor costs, easy access to normal farm produce, and high electricity prices, which describes a lot of the European markets that this was targeted for. Ultimately, the entire industry was predicated on a bet that vertical farms established right near customers with higher levels of sustainability and better water management, which is all true, could produce a product that was cheaper than a developing nation with copious amounts of sunshine and rain normally, and the cost of shipping it. And that gamble just didn't pay off. But there is a silver lining. Most large vertical farming companies are relocating in hot and arid climates where there's a lot of renewable energy, like in the Middle East. This is what's making huge construction projects like Saudi Arabia's line possible. How else do you feed millions of people in a linear city? Also, while many companies are going under, the vertical farming industry at large is actually still growing, with a compound annual growth rate of about 25%. If we figure out how to further automate these farms and the hardware and prices go down as economies of scale are reached, could we actually see this work? And the answer is kind of maybe. Ultimately, this is still a wager between humans and engineering versus Mother Nature and the sun. And where you fall kind of depends upon your outlook. But if you thought this was interesting, you're not going to believe this video. Gotta watch next.